Blackstone Publishing presents Archie Goes Home, a Nero Wolfe mystery by Robert Goldsborough. This book is read by L.J. Ganser. To John O'Loughlin and Francis Scott for their constant enthusiasm and encouragement. Chapter 1. This all began innocently, although I have been around long enough to be suspicious of what seems to be an innocuous telephone call like the one I received on a sunny June morning as I sat in the office with coffee after breakfast. The voice at the other end belonged to my Aunt Edna, who was phoning from down in southern Ohio, the area where I was born and reared. Edna usually calls when she's concerned about my mother, which has gotten to be a little more frequently the last few years. "Is it about Mom?" I asked, clenching the receiver as if I were trying to strangle it.
"Oh, well, she is all right, Archie. She is just fine," my aunt said without conviction. "And please don't tell her that I telephoned you. I have enough of a reputation as a busybody as it is."
"Then what is the problem?" "I learned long ago that you don't rush Edna Wainwright, my mother's slightly younger sister. She is going to tell a story at her own pace, and there is nothing anyone can do to speed her up. Maybe that's because of where she lives. Everything in that hilly, semi-rural region down near the Ohio River moves at a pace New Yorkers would call excruciatingly slow." I leaned back in my desk chair and drained the last of Fritz Brenner's fine brew from my cup. The sweep second hand on my watch had nearly made a full revolution when Aunt Edna cleared her throat. "Progress."
"I am sure that you must remember Logan Mulgrew."
"How could I forget him, even after all the years I've been away?" I said. "He has run the Farmers State Bank and Trust since long before I snuck out of town and headed to New York, lo, those many eons ago."
"He doesn't run it anymore, Archie. He was found dead at home 3 days ago."
"Hardly a surprise. He must have been close to 80, wasn't he?"
84, to be exact. "But he did not die of natural causes," Aunt Edna said. "When he had not shown up at the bank for 2 days, his grandniece got worried and went to his house. You know, that big old pile of brick and stone south of town out on the Portsmouth Road, not far from where your mother lives."
"I remember the house well. It was the largest place around by far, wasn't it?"
"And without doubt the gloomiest," she said. "Logan had lived there alone ever since his wife Sylvia died early last year, and they never had any children. Anyway, when Donna Newman, that's the grandniece, went into the house, she found her uncle dead on the sofa in the living room, with a hole in his temple and a pistol lying on the seat cushion next to his outstretched hand. He had been dead for some time."
"Suicide," I said.
"Not likely,"
Aunt Edna replied, in a tone that defied contradiction.
"I probably knew Logan as well as almost anyone in the area, and he was not a man to take his own life. That much I can say."
"He probably found out that he had a terminal illness, and he didn't want to—"
"No, Archie, no,"
my aunt interrupted.
"His grandniece said he recently had a checkup, and the physician found him so fit that he could have passed for a man at least 15 years younger."
"What did the police think?"
"The police, that would be our young chief, Tom Blankenship, has said the doctor who examined the body found nothing to indicate anything suspicious in the way of a disease."
"What is your opinion of this Blankenship?"
"Oh, he's all right, I suppose,"
Edna said dismissively.
"He has been on the job for 5, well, almost 6 years now, and there really hasn't been much crime around here, unless you count a car chase after a hold-up in which a couple of shots got fired, which fortunately didn't hit anybody. This isn't like New York, you know, where violence is just a way of life."
"It really is not that bad," I told her, but I was not about to press the point. I knew the image that small-town America, Aunt Edna included, has of New York and other large cities, while exaggerated, contains some merit. "So, what do you plan to do about Mr. Mulgrew's death?"
"It has been quite a while since you came down here to see your mother,"
Edna remarked, in what seemed to be a non sequitur, but I knew damned well what she was up to. "You are aware that she spent 2 weeks with me in New York just a couple of years ago," I said, in an attempt to parry her.
"That simply is not the same," she replied. "I know, Archie, that she would love to have you stay with her for a time."
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.